This video comes as a request. It is from somebody I have known for 20 years and they have always supported the things that I've done. So I decided to do this. I had one video, I scrapped it. This is what I came up with and it is by request. A lot of people make requests. If you want your request to rise up to the top, an easy way to do that is supporting me on Patreon and becoming a $20 supporter. I have other rewards on Patreon, go check that out. But today, we're going to talk about the super producer from the West Coast, DJ Quik.
Great producer. I'm one of the best producers that ever lived.
I mean, they put us out there, but they didn't pay us. For years, I had to fight with the owner of Profile Records to get a royalty statement, to get a publishing statement, you know. And it's unfortunate that I signed that contract in a day when rappers really had no real voice except what they was doing on the records in front of the camera. Behind the scenes, I mean, if you didn't know the business, then you learned the hard way, and that's what happened.
To many people, DJ Quik is just a rapper, but to others, he's this super producer and great engineer. He played a big part in developing some of Death Row's biggest albums or records, and he played a big part in All Eyes on Me, Tupac's double album.
I had something to do with Tupac's, you know, career, helping him get to as big as he was by engineering the All Eyes on Me album. Like, if you look at the credits, I'm on there as David Blake, but if you look at how many times I'm on there, you'll see who like kind of masterminded that whole project. And she gave me a wink. He knew I knocked that out the park. As a matter of fact, that's the album, the only album that like Billboard calls a master stroke.
Oh shit, you done fucked up, man. You done put two of America's most wanted in the same motherfucking place at the same.
Dr. Dre was the number one producer. You know, a lot of us was running around being little musical henchmen. As I put it, you know, I stayed in the studio most of the time in the lab, trying to, you know, further the musical styles of Danny Boy and Jewel and Tupac and, you know, Daz and Corrupt. I'm just, you know, trying to help.
Producing is a lot more than just laying down beats. It's developing a sound. It's crafting and orchestrating those hits that we hear and making those songs that we love and get up and dance to, all that sort of thing. Producing and hit making, two different things, but you can be hit making while you're producing. DJ Quik makes hits when he produces.
I mean, the funny thing is, people that make hit records don't always know it's a hit. And anybody that tell you, I know that's a hit, some of them be lying. There's only very few people I know that know they made a hit, like Sting, Babyface. Them the kind of motherfuckers that know they made a hit. You know what I mean? Because they just do the shit instinctively. They just born with it. And Nate Dogg, and Dr. Dre,
yeah,
and Snoopy, crazy ass, and
that's the rumor.
Yeah, no, that's truth. Bullshit ain't nothing. Chewed up grass.
Major Court. Can you believe them motherfuckers? They was on some shit.
DJ Quik pretty much taught himself producing and music production at a very young age, maybe 12, 13, 14.
Me, I wasn't born music. I kind of learned it. I always had a feel for it and I could understand chord changes, but I had to learn it. But some people like Donny Hathaway, they were born music.
My secret to making hits is just do something that ain't nobody ever done before, but make it sound like something that's always been there forever.
Started, it was always the drum beat first.
Okay.
Always the drum machine first. It was like a raw beat, no nothing. And then we put the music in later. But as I matured, it's like now it's more, I get the melody first.
Okay.
And I work from the top of the idea down,
right,
as opposed to the drums up.
It's all math. If you ever want to understand music to the kids that really want to do this, you gotta know math. You gotta know math and science to do music, because The math part will let you know exactly what keys you want to play, what chords you want to play, and the science part is about making it timely enough to play it when people want to hear it.
Quik produced for so many people, from Whitney Houston to 8-Ball and MJG, so many, many people.
I like to ask the artists that I produce for what colors they want or which flavors they want. Like, what do you want this record to sound like? And what time zone do you want to go to? Do you want it to sound like a 1980s record? Do you want it to sound like a 70s record? Do you want it to sound like an early 90s record when we were all experimenting with sampling? It's like, I like to be like a time traveler in a sense. And I need to know that the artist that I'm working with wants to go there too.
But there's a big difference in producing the music and stylings of a song and mixing and engineering. He had to teach himself engineering too.
I started when I was like 14 with the little Tascam 4-tracks, you know, overdub. And I used to have cassette decks and I needed, you know, back in the day, if you needed more tracks, you just dumped from cassette to cassette. But each time you did that, you lost a generation of music and you got more noise.
Yeah.
So the less you copy, the better it will sound. So when the 4-tracks came out, I started learning how to, what they call ping pong, where you bounce tracks. So I pretty much taught myself.
And the best always make it seem like it's easier than it actually is, because hey, maybe it just comes easy to them.
Turn that one down, turn it up. Just engineer, you gotta, you know, engineer it is, you turn some things up and some things down.
Man.
That's all it is.
Right.
Some things should be loud, some things should be quiet.
Truth is, the engineer can make or break a record.
The last point that music hits before it gets to y'all, like the most important point, is from the quarterback's hands. And that's me in there on that console.
Engineers don't get recognized and praised as much as others in the business who are more visible, at least not publicly.
You know, the way Dre and Yella was putting them pan, them gunshots and hi-hats and all that, I wanted to do that. And I'm still on that. It don't matter now as much as it did. No, I don't think it's appreciated.
Right, right.
No, but I don't care. You know, again, I've always been a little bit ahead of my time, and I ain't trying to toot my own horn, but that's kind of what it is. I'm a great producer. I'm one of the best producers that ever lived.
But when you've done as much as DJ Quik, people in the industry will recognize you and give you your props behind closed doors.
As an engineer, I'm respected in all them circles and studios. When I walk into the studios, these dudes bow down. They know what I do, you know, and they know that I'm going to leave their studio better than it was before I got there.
I don't know if DJ Quik will be brought up ever in those conversations when we talk about hip hop's best producers or best producers of all time. Will he be alongside Dr. Dre and Timbaland and stuff like that? Maybe because we aren't aware of all of his accomplishments. So I don't know, but the dude was a triple threat. He rapped, he produced, and he engineered. And he was good at all three. Like, who else can say that? You may have some people who are good producers, not that good rappers not that good at producing. And when it comes to mixing and all that, you know, that's a whole different ball game. But he was a triple threat and he was good at all three.
I wanna be acknowledged, not just at the Grammy Museum, but I wanna be acknowledged and be nominated at least for one Grammy. For a good record, for a record that makes sense to young and old. You know, just to show that I did my homework with all the music that I grew up with and keeping it linear. You know, I've worked with Marcus Miller, you know. I've hung out with Quincy Jones. Like, I get it. Damn. I just want to be taken seriously. I think they just see me as a gangbanger or just some hoodlum, man. And it's almost like, it's kind of disrespectful, you know, in a sense. That I don't really get the props that I deserve. But, hell, I know I'll probably be just one of those artists that gets it posthumously. And that's fine too.
Hit that subscribe button, hit the bell, check out the links in the description.
The one thing about the 90s, it went by too fast. I think we took it for granted. We didn't think that shit was ever gonna end. Everybody was number one. We was dropping hit records at will, doing movie score, having fun. And then it got ignorant and it became not fun. Then it got scary and dark and, you know, and detrimental. How could something so beautiful turn so fucking putrid and weird?
Let me know what I got right. Let me know what I got wrong.
Roger Troutman was the best. Most talented motherfucker in the world. Curtis Mayfield is my favorite. It's so many, like even Aaliyah, like what her and Timbaland was doing. Like, these are some incredible motherfuckers we can't get back. Music, we lost all the best motherfuckers. We're pretty much missing the whole A-team of hip-hop and R&B right now.
Let me know what you want to see from me in the future. It's Heit.